Beautiful. It's extremely generous. Okay, reports and correspondence. Counselors? Nothing? Well, I have just a couple of things. I want to congratulate Jimmy Murray on another wonderful organization of the Memorial Day festivities. I marched in the parade yesterday, and it was fabulous. It was a fabulous day. It was a huge turnout. I don't think I've ever seen such a big crowd from the Memorial Day festivities, and I just want to thank him and everyone who worked so hard to organize the day. I also want to thank the fire department personnel and the police department personnel who staffed the open houses at the various, at the new fire station and police station. And they did a great job of showing people around, and I waited online for a while to get in to see the new police station, and it seemed as though people were very impressed. So thank you very much. I also want to mention that about, what was it, 2 weeks ago? 2 weeks ago, Portland Headlight was recognized as a National Civil Engineering Historic Landmark by the American Society of Civil Engineers, and they presented us with this plaque. We received the town, received recognition from the President of the Senate and the Speaker of the House, and I want to thank the civil engineers. They were a good group, and they were very kind, presented us with a beautiful bronze memorial plaque. A number of the counselors were there, as was Mr. McGovern, and they were very impressed with the town of Cape Elizabeth. Some of them had not been here before and had not seen the headlight before and were very impressed. So that is good recognition for the town. And lastly, I just want to take a moment to thank Jim Rowe for his service on the school board. He's outgoing and won't be, this is probably the last public meeting I'll see him as a fellow official, but I'm sure I'll see him as a citizen. I want to thank you, Jim, for all your contributions to the town in the many different ways and roles that you've performed over the years. So we won't forget you. Thank you. Are there anything else from counselors, reports, correspondence? Are there any citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda? Is there anyone out there who wants to add something to the agenda? Okay, I guess not. Then we have the next up is the minutes of the meeting held, the town council meeting held May 13th. Do I hear a motion?
I move approval.
Second.
It's been moved.
On page 7, there's a typo there that should be corrected. It said descending vote, and what it should be is dissenting vote, but other than that, it's all right.
I think our municipal clerk had already picked that one up, but thank you for bringing that to our attention.
That's what came in my mail. All
right. Anything else? No. Any other discussion?
Yeah, I would like to ask that the minutes be amended to also include as an attachment the slides that Councillor Roberts projected or showed at the last meeting. I think that they should be incorporated in the minutes.
Okay. Any other items to discuss? It's been moved and seconded. All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Okay. This is a special meeting of the town council, and basically what we're here tonight to talk about is the budget, the town's budget as a whole, not just the municipal budget, but all budgets. And we have a number of items. I think they go from item number 147 to 166. I believe there are agendas up back for people who may want to travel, look along with us. The council may, if it so desires, discuss and consider these items or some sets of these items as a block, and we will move forward with hearing that. But I just want to sort of introduce with the process what we're going to do tonight. Tonight we're holding a special meeting to consider items having to do with the town's fiscal year 03 budget. The budget process is now finally coming to an end after about 6 months of work. At our last meeting on May 13th, the council heard comments from the public, mostly having to do with the school budget, although there were a few other comments on some other subjects. Tonight is the formal public hearing on the budget. We invite anyone who wishes to speak about any budget item or issue to speak about it. This is your chance. I do want to note for the record, however, that since the council's last meeting, the finance chairs of the town council and the school board, that is Jack Roberts and Kevin Sweeney, respectively, have put together an alternate budget proposal that both meets the targeted bottom line of 94 cents for a tax rate increase and also takes into account comments and priorities heard from the school board, the town council, and many citizens. Both the town manager and the superintendent of schools have reviewed this proposal, and according to Jack and Kevin's letter, which I believe copies of which are up back for your reference, both managers, both the superintendent and the town manager, quote, believe that the proposal is sound in terms of program support and fiscal responsibility, unquote. So I want to take this opportunity to thank both finance chairs, Kevin Sweeney and Jack Roberts. I want to thank the town manager and the superintendent for their work to develop a proposal which meets the educational needs of Cape school children and at the same time is responsive to the financial constraints faced by Cape taxpayers. The alternate numbers are noted on the agenda. The agenda's up back, and within a little box under item 148, there are some alternate amounts, which are the numbers that the two finance chairs have proposed. The council has not met on this proposal yet. This is our first formal discussion of it, and we will be voting tonight. What we will do now is we'll have the public hearing to hear comments from citizens, and then it'll come back to me, and then we will go through the various items, and the council will vote on all these various items. So that's it. Yes.
You emphasize that this is for all the items. The public hearing is for all the items, including the fee structure and everything, just so that it's not just the school budget.
Yes.
It's every.
I thank you for that addition. You are very correct. I'm glad you brought that up. This public hearing is not just to do with the school budget, but it is to do with the school budget, community services budget, all the special funds budgets, the municipal budget. It has to do with some items that have to do with spring cleanup week. There are proposed changes to a number of different fees. Everything on this agenda is what we're having the public hearing about. So if you want to talk to us about mooring fees, now's your chance. And it's the time for comments from the public on the school budget or on anything else having to do with the budget. We'd be happy to hear from you on revenues, on spending, on the county budget increases, on community services, you name it. I do want to just note, however, I'm sure most of you who are here in this room know it because you're pretty active in the budget process, but for people who are at home who may not know, I just want to emphasize the council has no control over how exactly the increased school budget should be spent. We're happy to hear your comments, and there are some members of the school board here, and I'm sure they'd be happy to hear your comments about your educational priorities for your children, but it is the board's job under the town charter to decide exactly how to spend those dollars. We have quite a few people here tonight, so in the interest of saving the time that you have to spend sitting through our meeting, I would just ask that in the public hearing, please keep your comments brief and to the point, if possible, so that everyone who wants to speak may do so. Also, it helps speed things up if people line up. It doesn't have to be 50 people long or anything like that, but if everyone gets up one at a time and sits down one at a time, it's going to prolong the time that you have to sit out there in your seats. So if you wouldn't mind lining up at least two or three people in a row, if that works for you, that's fine, but whatever works for you. And lastly, could you please state your name and address into the microphone so that everyone at home who's watching on TV will know who is speaking. So that being said, I declare the public hearing open, and who wants to be the first person? Jim Rowe.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for the kind comments earlier.
Well, they're well deserved, Mr. Rowe.
Thank you. My name is Jim Rowe, and I live at 127 Oakhurst Road. And I stand before you tonight to urge your approval of the compromise school budget as negotiated by Finance Chairs Roberts and Sweeney, Town Manager McGovern, and Superintendent Forcella. I'm hopeful and confident that we can get beyond the emotion and the passion of self-interest and come together for the good of the townspeople of Cape Elizabeth and for the good of our schools. This compromise budget offers us such an opportunity, and I hope we don't miss that opportunity. It has consistently been my position in this process that everyone needs to step back often and see the whole picture, to walk in each other's shoes, if you will, to appreciate the needs of our property taxpayers as well as the needs of those families who are seeking the best education possible for their children. Passion is important, but no less important to me is sensitivity. There is more at stake here tonight than a few thousand budget dollars. Tonight, we all need to step back once again and realize and appreciate the importance of a strong inter-board working relationship. That, too, is at stake. Again, I hope we don't miss this opportunity. I consider each of you at the dais tonight to be a personal friend. I can say the same for my colleagues on the school board, and also for the person who will be joining the school board on June 10th. I'm asking first, friend to friends, that you make the right decision tonight. And I'm also asking that everyone commit to a renewed spirit of collegiality, understanding, and cooperation. I can't emphasize enough how important I believe this is today, May 28th, 2002, and also how important it will be in the coming weeks, months, and years. In closing, I want to take this opportunity to thank the Town Council for its patience in working with me personally these past 3 years, and also for faithfully performing its duty under very trying circumstances. Please know that you have my heartfelt appreciation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else like to speak? I see some people sort of twitching in their seats. I just want to make sure. Would you like to speak, ma'am?
I'm Sally Cox. I live at 23 Saltsbury Lane.
Excuse me. Could you just pull the microphone down a little bit? Thank you.
Okay. Sally Cox, 23 Saltsbury Lane. I don't have prepared remarks, but I've been somewhat concerned about the directions that taxes have been taking. And I went to the library to look at past budgets. And the only year I found was 1997. And I would start by requesting that perhaps the town put all the year's budgets in the library so they're available to town people to look at them. Also, there was no school budget whatsoever. However, 1997 was 5 years ago, and so that's not a bad point to take off from. Let's see if I've got my numbers here. I gather that the budget, my remarks actually, the reason I was hesitating coming up right now is my remarks are more things to think about in the future. I realize that you've put a lot of thought into the budget plans at this point, and I'm really not here to rain on that parade, but I do have some thoughts about maybe how we should handle things in the future. Anyway, in 1997, the town municipal budget, which did not include the school budget, was about $5,400,000. If you subtract out the school budget from this year's, or from the 03 figures, you get something like $8,600,000, which is an increase of about 60% over a period of 5 years. So I just want people to realize that, and to realize that at the same time, businesses across the country have cut their costs relative to their revenues. I guess I would like to see, one other thing concerns me a little bit about how this town is run. I came from a town where we had town meetings and the town decided, voted on these things. Also, we had a separate finance committee which advised the town council, and in Cape Elizabeth, the town council and the finance committee are the same people, and I gather the school committee and the school finance committee are the same people. And I think it's unfortunate that we don't, that there's so few people here tonight, that there's not more citizen concern about these things. And I wonder if the town council could have a more systematic input from the town in the process of reviewing these things, one, using the internet more, using the town crier, maybe having small group hearings. Those are just some ideas. But my specific suggestion or really recommendation is that for 2004, that we have a goal of 0% increase in the budget. And, you know, I take the attitude that you were under constraint and you absolutely could not increase. We've increased every single year, and I am afraid that people are going to move out of the town. We spend over 66% of the budget on schools, and the school population, I believe, is something around 10% of the population of Cape Elizabeth. So I think things are a little out of whack, and I think if we got more input from more people, including school children, on coming up with creative ideas, I just feel as though we've reached a point where we can't go any higher.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak? I feel like I should have a gavel saying going once, going twice. No other public comments? Okay. Thank you very much. I declare the public hearing closed. I want to thank our commenters for their thoughtful comments and the spirit in which you offered them. And I just want to know that your input, as well as the input of everyone else who has commented all along the way during this budget process, either through their emails or phone calls or talking to people at Jonesy's or IGA or wherever, it has helped, your input has helped make the process work better, and it helps all of us make better informed decisions. I do want to note that even though at some points in the past the school board and the town council have disagreed about some points and have reached at times some different conclusions, I hope everybody appreciates the hard work that the school board, the school administration, the town council, and the town manager and his staff have put into this process. I want to emphasize that everyone in this discussion has good intentions and is trying to do the right thing. And no matter how often we may disagree, I thank them for their service and their hard work, and I hope Cape citizens do also. So that concludes the public hearing part. I guess we need to move on to our items. And the first item is item number 147, which is a proposal to eliminate spring cleanup week.
Yes, Madam Chair, I wanted to make some comments about this to the citizens who are here and those that are on television that probably in my 15 years in the council, there's never really been more than a handful of people out here to hear a municipal budget, but there's always a lot to hear the school budget. So I wanted to comment a little about this. When we were making our cuts in our budget to try and bring our budget down below 3% increase, which included our fixed fees that had to be paid, one of the things that we talked about for a long time was the cutting of one of the cleanups, either the spring cleanup or the fall cleanup. And in the end, after a lot of discussion, and I particularly did not want to do this, but there were others too, this was a very, you know, when you're dealing with your school children and your school programs, you think, well, what's the deal on a spring cleanup? But it was one of the few things that I received after the budget process on the television and after we had the last public hearing, a lot of comments about. I've lived in this town all my life, and I have to say that there wasn't too many people below 35 that were calling me on the telephone about spring cleanup. But there were comments such as, everybody has an SUV in this town, and I don't have one, so I can't move things. I've lived here a long time, and I've counted on the spring and fall cleanup to help me keep my property tidy. These are all different comments. People have trucks in this town and big vehicles, and I don't have anything like that, so I can't move things out of my yard. I just can't get things to the dump. It's always been a wonderful service that was offered here, and now you're going to take it away. And why does everything have to go to the schools? What about us that don't have any children anymore? We're willing to pay, but we want some services in our community. So these were just some of the comments that came to me on the telephone from people that I've known for a long time. And I raised this issue with some of my counselors that I did see. And what I would like to recommend is that at this time, we do not vote to eliminate the spring cleanup, but that we vote to set it aside for the moment, which I hesitate to use the word right off the bat, but until we find out what's going to happen to our revenues, where are we going to be, how is this all going to shake down, and see if we can do something for these citizens who really want that. One of the other comments that they made, and I'm not sure how much of this is true unless I would speak to our Public Works Director, is that people abuse the cleanups. These were some of the things I also heard, is that people would hire somebody to come in to clear the land, to take down trees and brush and shrubs, and hired people to drag all that down to the road, and then they would expect the town to come and pick it up for free. And that is really an abuse of the system in a way. This is a helpful thing for citizens. So what would happen, our Public Works Department would have to send over two huge pickup trucks, a front-end loader, and four or five guys. And this all adds up to the time, the overtime, the cost, or whatever it is. So there are several possible things that we might think about in the future when we get to raise the issue again, hopefully. And that is that we may be able to limit one of these to no brush, or to limit the amount of brush that's put out. People commented to me that, you know, if I have a mattress or a washing machine, I simply have no way of getting it out of my yard. So there are issues within the cleanup itself. And I want to impress upon people, to a lot of citizens out there, these are the kinds of services that are important to them. It's something that they've always had and that they'd like to be able to have some part of it back. So I would like to move that the council table this issue to a time indefinite when we are able to examine the issue, the revenues, and the status of the fall cleanup.
And if I could just interject just for a moment before it's seconded, or now that the motion's been made, is there no discussion? Or is it after it's seconded?
After it's seconded.
That's why I'm interjecting right now, because I don't want to cut off discussion. So before anybody potentially seconds this, if anybody wants to say anything about spring cleanup, speak.
This is a tabling motion. They can even vote to table or not vote to table. I don't think there's any discussion.
Well, we haven't heard a second yet.
Has anybody seconded it?
So if anybody wants to make a comment before there is any potential second.
I'd be glad to second it, but I want to clarify we're not putting money back into the budget at this point.
Correct.
That what I understand you to be looking for is that we, A, are waiting to see what happens in Augusta, because mm-hmm. that's crucial mm-hmm. to our financial stability. Going forward, and second, that we find $15,000 in the budget to relook at this issue. Is that right?
Well, I'd like to have you relook at it, and you may at the future date decide absolutely we're going to cut it.
are absolutely the numbers have changed, and I think we can do part of it.
Yeah.
Any number of things.
But we're not increasing
we are not.
The full budget tonight. Okay.
No, we're not.
Then I will second. I don't want to cut off discussion.
Well, I have one thing I
would say. You want to retract your second
I'll
for a moment?
I'll retract my second.
No, I just wanted to mention that we are setting up a study of waste systems mm-hmm. and how we handle all the waste in the town, and that would certainly be the subject that committee would take up and make recommendations, and that recommendation is supposed to be the end of the year, this year. So that would be before a spring cleanup, and we'd have better information.
Then it seems appropriate to discuss it all at one time.
Are there any other comments before anyone seconds this? No. Now, do I hear a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to table this indefinitely, or did you say indefinitely?
Indefinitely.
Indefinitely. To table this indefinitely, and there can be no discussion on this motion, so all in favor of tabling it? It's unanimous. Thank you.
I'll be checking my Robert's rules as soon as I come.
Well, we might have been a little creative about the Robert's rules.
Okay, it worked.
I think it worked, okay. Okay. Next we come to item number 148. And as I said at the beginning of the evening, we may decide for, there are many items on this agenda. I would like to suggest that we look at this one separately, and then there are some others we may want to consider as a block later on. We have a bunch of items 149 through 155, our various special funds budgets, but I think item 148, unless anyone has objections, should be dealt with just in and of itself. So this one has to do with the municipal, school, community services, and county budgets. There is text here, but there are also some alternate amounts at the side. Do I hear a motion? Councilor Roberts.
Madam Chairman, I would move that it be ordered that the people of the town council, having held a public hearing on Tuesday, May 28, 2002, now, hereby adopt the general fund budget for fiscal year 2003 with gross expenditures of $23,557,130 and gross revenues of $6,810,992 and with the amount of $16,746,138 to be raised from taxation and to fix Thursday, October 3, 2002 and Thursday, October 3, 2003 as the dates upon which of one half of such tax is due and payable. I'll leave it. I think that's enough for the motion.
Yes, and the second date was April 3rd. You said October 3rd.
Yeah, sorry. April 3rd.
So just to clarify, the numbers that are being used are the ones not in the text, but the ones
the
over on the
amounts.
Side. Okay.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there discussion?
Madam Chairwoman. I have some comments that I would like to make, if you don't mind getting
don't
into
mind.
Some real
this
discussion
is the time.
On it. And I guess to address this to people in the public as well. As the current budget process draws to a close, I hope we can all agree that each of us has the best interest of Cape Elizabeth at heart. If we didn't, we wouldn't be here. Clearly, the budget resolved before us is at a level that many will tell you is inadequate. Just as many feel the tax is too high. Putting together a budget when resources are uncertain and dwindling has taxed the patience of everyone, but we'll get through it. To have been able to meet all of the needs identified by both the town and the school simply is not possible. Fortunately, we have extremely capable administrators in Tom, Mike, and their staff who will once again work their miracles. Both budgets are sound in terms of program and support and fiscal responsibility. They have the full support of the town manager and the school superintendent. I want to take a second to thank Jim Rowe. I'm going to embarrass you again, Jim, for his comments on May 13, 2002. It was his calm and reasoned position that allowed the compromise before us to proceed forward. I also want to thank my counterpart, Kevin Sweeney, for his willingness to work out an acceptable arrangement that does not increase the tax rate, but does meet the needs of both boards. I especially want to thank our town manager and school superintendent for their attention to details. and to thank my fellow counselors and school board members for being willing to ask the tough questions and getting us to a budget we can all agree on. In the spirit of respect for the fact that we are all duly elected officials, I would urge my fellow counselors to pass the compromise budget offered by the two finance chairs. It stands at 94 cents. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Councilor Roberts. Are there other comments?
Is this an opportunity for someone to explain, I mean, for you, someone to explain a little bit to people who may not know how the compromise budget, about the, just at least about the freezer and the money and how that changed? I see some nods. There's some people who would like to understand what the compromise budget is, where it was.
That's a good idea, but also just so people know, there are copies up back of the, for lack of a better word, compromise letter, which explains exactly what this alternate proposal is, and it explains exactly how the money's being shifted around. So there's hard copies of this, too, if anybody wants to look on. Councilor Roberts, do you want
to
do that?
I think one item in particular
made a difference.
Councilor Carson, excuse me, would like to have the issue of the freezer explained, as that was a major concern on the school board's part. And we felt that, based on Jennifer DeSena's comments, that in fact the freezer was a hazard and an accident waiting to happen. So rather than waiting and having that take place, we are going to carry money forward to get it into the budget process. We'll get one ordered and get it taken care of as quickly as one can do those type of things. That is the issue there. There was also money...
It's going to come from the town side.
It will be coming from the town side, correct, to help pick that up out of from surplus. Additional funds that had not been budgeted that were in our budget were $2,000 for the computer network assistance. The school is going to have up to $70,000 of surplus that they can use. We had talked about 30 originally. The school board still needs to make some reductions. There are savings in energy and telephone, and the school board will be working on that. Kevin may want to address further, or maybe we can just let it go at this point. Kevin, are you comfortable with what I've said so far? Or?
Apparently not quite.
Apparently not quite. Okay, go, Kevin.
Actually, I'm quite comfortable with what you've said so far, Jack. The only thing I wanted to touch on was the balance of the cuts that we have made. We had proposed some initial cuts, and I have been out of town for a while. I know that there has been conversation about that $58,000 plus, but I am embarrassed that I am not up to date on the status of those. So we will come back and let you know the status as soon as I know what the answer is.
And just for people watching on TV, that was Kevin Sweeney, the finance chair of the school board. Thank you.
Okay. That's good.
Okay, that's enough of an explanation. As I said, there are copies. For the people in the room, there are copies in the back of the room, and I'm sure anyone else who's watching on television who wants to know the nitty-gritty specifics could get a copy of that from the town manager's office. So
probably also be put on the website, as had been recommended.
The letter's already on the website.
It's on the website.
The letter is on the website, so it's available in that way, too. And while I'm addressing the town manager, did you want to clarify a number that was brought up in the public hearing?
I just wanted to respond very briefly to Ms. Cox's comments about the municipal budget being up 60%. As you might guess, I'd be a little concerned about that percentage hanging out there. That is over an eight-year period, including all the different budgets. It does include $560,000 that is now in for the swimming pool and fitness center that was not at all in the municipal budget back in 1997. So that's a major shift. Just the pool, the fitness center, and the county tax alone are $1 million of that increase. There's also, 1997 was one of the nadirs, so to speak, of where we were in municipal debt service for different projects. And as an article that was listed under Chairman Ann Swift Kayada's name in the Cape Courier recently explained, The debt service the town has taken on equals 5% of the total tax bill, not just municipal, the total tax bill. So that is equally a good percentage. I apologize to Ms. Cox that all of the numbers that you were looking for weren't available in the library. What I'll commit to doing for you and for anyone else is to go back to 1997 and to take every single municipal department year by year and show the increases from 1997 to 2003. Because I think, you know, that 60% number out there alone sounds very large. But when you look through at the shift of the pool, you look at the shift of the county, as well as the debt service, most of the rest of the municipal budget is actually a much lower percentage, with the one big exception of health insurance, which is just in this year's budget alone is up $70,000. So I'll probably try to get those numbers to you, if not by the end of this week, sometime next week. So, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Are there other comments from councilors? Yes, Councilor McGinty.
First, on the freezer issue, I have a problem, difficulty with taking monies from the undesignated fund balance to pay for CIP, a capital improvement project item. I think that's poor fiscal policy to start doing that, to take money out of our undesignated fund. If we want to fund this, then we should put it in our budget and not rely on that undesignated fund to fund these types of issues. I mean, I see this as a slippery slope. We go for the freezer this year, and what's it going to be next year? I mean, I don't know what it might be. It could be anything. But that should be a budget issue that should be included in the budget, not taken out of undesignated surplus. That's my opinion. I think it sets a bad precedent for the undesignated fund. That should be there for essentially emergency.
Thank you, Councilor McGinty. Are there other comments from councilors? Yes. Councilor Lynch.
Okay. I'll make a few comments. I also want to join the accolades thanking outgoing school board member Jim Rowe for his role in developing this compromise. From my perspective, your comments at our last hearing on the school budget did not fall on deaf ears. I also want to thank the Finance Committee Chair Jack Roberts and Kevin Sweeney, the school board committee chair, for rolling up their sleeves and coming up with a compromise and working as hard as they did and calling each of us and working to try and come up with something. We've been informed that both the superintendent of the school and the town manager believe that the compromise budget is sound in terms of both school program support and the fiscal responsibility that we owe our taxpayers. I think it's also important to note that through the use of this year's surplus, next year's compromise budget will not increase taxes beyond the 4.3% that we originally recommended as a finance committee. Having said that, however, I also want to say I'm not happy with a 4.3% tax increase, but I do believe that that's an increase necessary to support the school programs and the level of services that the people in this town expect. So for those reasons, I will be supporting the compromise budget. But I also want to add a word of caution to the budget going forward. I spent a day last week at the Maine Municipal Association where the major part of the discussion was about the $180 million deficit for fiscal year starting July 1 that the state is facing. And the general expectation is that absent a 1 cent increase on the sales tax, the governor and the legislature will be forced to cut municipal revenue sharing and general purpose aid to education. I don't know about the rest of you, but I'm rather skeptical that there will be a tax increase in an election year. It might be the responsible thing to do, but and I hope that there is a sales tax increase to plug this gap, but I don't see that happening. So I think prudent planning dictates that both the town manager and the superintendent anticipate more state cuts later this year. And we may not know the outcome or the level of those cuts until sometime next spring when the legislature comes back into session. So I just want to take this opportunity to urge the town manager and the superintendent to move very slowly in committing dollars out of the budget that we approved tonight. I think we need to move slowly in hiring and in major purchases, and whatever we do, we need to maintain contractual flexibility as we move forward in order to deal with the uncertainty that we're going to face in Augusta. And finally, I would like to thank all the citizens who've taken the time in recent weeks to email me, call me, stop me in the IGA, stop me in the fitness center, talk to me at church about these budget issues. I appreciate all the input that I receive from all of you, and I take very seriously my obligation to represent all the citizens and to come up with a budget that's supported by the majority of citizens. So that's where I am, and I will be supporting the compromise. I hope that my fellow councilors do as well.
Thank you, Councilor Lynch. Councilor Carson.
I was wondering about something that I didn't understand. I am planning to support the compromise budget, but I thought that Councilor McGinty's point was very well taken. To solve the budget problem by taking out of the surplus is not necessarily probably the best thing to do, since we're expected to hold a surplus at a certain amount, and that you're right. We take the freezer out this time, and next year we solve the budget problem by doing the same thing again. But one of the things that I don't remember what the answer was the police cruiser. Seems to me when we left the last workshop, there was some information we were going to get. The manager was going to give us some information about what the mileage was or what the price was of the new cruiser. And I didn't know that we had actually voted on it. So I didn't know what the status was of the cruiser, which is a big hit. So I didn't know what happened to it.
Yeah. Yeah. Mr. Manager.
Thank you. My recollection of the understanding on that issue is that there are two police cruisers that are in this year's proposed municipal budget. We actually would not replace both police cruisers until just, you know, automatically, that at the, again, similar to any other issue, just prior to the time of replacement, we would at that point look at the mileage on all of those vehicles, the engine wear, all of those other issues, and decide whether to purchase one or to purchase two. If it ended up that we would only purchase one, we would then look at the remaining balance in that account with council authorization to fund some of the other items that nearly $1 million worth that would cut from the capital improvement plan beginning at the staff review level last fall. Obviously, with your earlier vote as well on cleanup week, that also raises a challenge that if the council wishes to revisit that some of those funds could come into play. But at this point, the intent is still to replace two police cruisers, and however, not to automatically do so, but to look at the mileage and the wear and tear on the vehicles at the time as we get closer to their actual replacement.
So we're voting tonight for two police cruisers, but we don't know yet whether we need two police cruisers.
We believe we need them, but we want to maintain the flexibility closer to the time to purchase them to perhaps put one off if that looks feasible at that point. It's happened once before, about 5 years ago, that we looked in for various reasons. There just wasn't as much mileage on one of the vehicles, and we decided to keep it.
When is the time that you're talking about? We're going to look at it at some certain time. When is that time?
I can't.
Oh, it's not some certain date.
No,
like
with
November.
Our schedules, you know, they give us dates, and you just don't know. But it will come back to the council when it's time.
Are there other comments? Yes. Councilor Fritz.
This has been quite a struggle, I think, and I've had quite a struggle within my own head on whether 4% was enough of an increase for the school budget or whether 4.5% was really enough. I think we've heard, we've had a very early meeting last year, as a matter of fact, with the school board and talked about the anticipated difficulties with the fiscal situation. And we knew that state funding was expected to be reduced for Cape Elizabeth. And we asked that the town manager present us with a budget that kept to 3%, and we asked the school board to do the same thing. And I very much appreciate that some really big items that the school board was considering, like actually putting a bond issue out this spring for renovation and building projects. And they didn't propose that in the budget. And also recognizing that high school portable classrooms were not going to be necessary, which seems pretty obvious to me in terms of the class size in the high school, but I think that was a good thing that was set aside. And Cape Elizabeth has not really had to have as large a cuts in the school as some of the other communities. I mean, South Portland closing schools, and so our situation in 4% increase is quite a bit. But I have wavered on it all, and I must give a great deal of credit to Jim Rowe, because I know that he is conservative fiscally and brings those issues to the school board, and for him to urge us to go with this compromise does make me change my mind. I actually walked in here tonight planning on voting for 4%, and I think in terms of the school board and the town council having decent relationship, I think that going with the larger increase is acceptable to me tonight. But I am very troubled by the school budget. I think that the fact that we have a decrease in population in the schools, that the inflation rate has been low, it seems to me we should not have to go more than 4%. I'm really worried that we're going to have increased cuts, and maybe we'll go back to the 700,000 loss that we were supposed to have instead of 450,000 from the state because of the shortfall. I think that this school funding formula is very unfair, and something needs to be done about it. I don't know that it's what's being talked about by, like, Portland, who also loses, because putting income into the formula, I'm not sure does us any good, but we need to work on getting our fair share of the money. I would like to urge the school board to be extremely conservative when you're planning for the renovations to the school, to really both schools are being proposed to be worked on. I hope we can do it without adding buildings, without doing extensive cost here, and that it's got to fall into a better budget cycle or bonding cycle when we've come down on the on our current bond rate or amount. And also, I'd like to urge that you talk with South Portland, the school board, talk with South Portland school board, because I think there ought to be places that both schools will be looking for savings. I mean, both towns took some heavy cuts from the state, and it's going to be bigger next year. So I urge you to do that. So I guess I will vote for the compromise, but 4% should have been enough.
Thank you, Councillor Fritz. Any other comments? Councillor Barry.
I'd just like to echo Councillor McGinnis and Carson's sentiments on the bookkeeping. I don't know, our president might call that fuzzy math, I guess, but I think the procedure should be to put that $25,000 in the budget. But I'm not going to hold up a vote on that, because we're looking at $23 million here. One point I think should be focused on that hasn't been mentioned, that's county government. We have no control. This council has unanimously voted not to pay the county, although the statute requires us to do it, but it was just a show of how we felt about the thing, because they went up 16% 2 years ago, and this year they're going up 21%. And we're struggling for 4 to 4.3, 4.2, we're talking very small numbers of increase compared to Cumberland County, which is going up 21% in 1 year. I think that's obscene. I think that reflects poor management, and I think that the situation down there ought to be corrected. We got together with the other communities in this county, and we tried to file a bill in the legislature. Our representatives in the legislature couldn't get it through. It died in the legislature, so we didn't get any relief there. I think that has to be readdressed in the coming year, and I think that the focus on county government and its expense should come to the forefront, because people just don't know what's happening. I'll vote for the budget.
Thank you very much, Councilor Berry. Yes, Councilor McGinty.
Sorry, Jim. Jim and I grew up together in town, so I hope we'll still be friends after this. I'm not going to support this budget for all the reasons that Mary Ann and Henry outlined. Mary Ann hit them all about the county, and Henry brought up the county. I think the uncertainty in the state budget, there's no doubt in my mind they're going to try to balance their budget on our backs one way or another. And I can see us taking a big hit in the GPA. During the current fiscal, or the 2003 fiscal year, and probably more next year, another $500,000 hit or whatever next year for the fiscal year 2004 budget. And the general revenue sharing, I think we're going to hit on that. $180 million is a lot of money to have to make up. And I see that directly impacting our budgets. And I think that we should be acting more conservatively in our spending this year in anticipation of that. I see us back here in 4, 5, 6 months adjusting our budget to deal with those cuts. So I guess I'll be the odd man out as usual and be voting against the budget.
Thank you, Councilor McGinty. Any further comments? Councilor Lynch.
Just one to Councilor McGinty. My comments were not intended to dissuade you from supporting the compromise, but rather were intended to suggest, for example, that the town manager does what he says he will do, which is before you go out and you buy that cruiser, let's make sure that we really need it. And if we can put it off and put it off and put it off, well, I hope we can put it off till February or March, so we know at that point what the legislature has done and whether we have some money to work with. So that was the intent. It was not...
I understand.
Because I think that the superintendent and the town manager do have that flexibility, at least in certain areas, to be as cautious as possible and husband their resources. So that was my intent there.
Yes, Councilor McGinty.
I understand what you're saying, and I agree with that. I would go further. I mean, I think we could be more aggressive instituting a hiring freeze, for instance, or other, fiscal policy till we see what's going to happen. That's just my point.
Thank you. Was there no other comments here?
One final comment.
A final comment.
We went through this okay. Last hearing, didn't we?
Yes, Councilor McGinty.
I just wanted to say that not a single person came up to me yesterday at the Memorial Day ceremonies and asked me to raise their taxes.
Well,
that was for veterans.
Thank you. I have a few comments myself, and I'll take this chance to make them before we move the question. As everyone is well aware in this room and in Cape Elizabeth, most towns and cities in Maine are facing economic challenges that are having grave impacts on our schools and other municipal services. All you have to do is read the paper to see that local town and school budgets are facing problems, many of them much more dire than ours. What I really want to say is that we, in this room and in this town, share a lot of common values. When we look carefully at the issues, we can see that our differences really are quite small. They may seem big sometimes, but in the whole scheme of things, our differences are really relatively small. We all
want to support the schools, and we all want to preserve the other aspects of Cape Elizabeth that make it such a wonderful place to live. The only thing that some of us disagree on, and like Councilor McGinty, is on just how much of an increase in taxes to accept. I believe we have come up with a good compromise, thanks to the good work of the two boards and of their finance chairs and the superintendent and the manager. I think it's a good compromise, but I do also agree that this is all the taxpayers can bear. People on fixed incomes, mostly senior citizens, should not be driven out of their homes because of their taxes. But taxes affect more people than just our older citizens. As I said in a previous meeting, I'm afraid that if we keep raising and raising and raising property taxes too much, we are going to price young families right out of Cape because they won't be able to afford to live here anymore. And if we keep young families out, the town is going to move towards being a community only of older and wealthier people with fewer and fewer people and children in the schools, and thus with less interest in the schools. And if that happens, if we drive young families out by making it too expensive to live here, then we'll be gutting the future of the schools, and no one wants that. This is a community of good people. I really believe that. We look at facts, not just emotion, when we discuss issues and we make decisions. We treat each other as neighbors, and I think Jim Rowe is a prime example of that. We respect each other's views and sincerity. We listen when others speak, even though we do not always agree. These are the things that make our community such a wonderful place to live and to raise our families. So in closing, I want to thank you all here and out in the community for taking the time to inform yourselves and give your input. Your part in the process is critical, and it helps the school board and the town council gain a better understanding of what citizens think on the issues that face us, your representatives. On behalf of both boards, I thank you for your ideas, your time, and your commitment. And I also will be supporting the alternate compromise proposal. So thank you for your time, and I'd like to move the question. All those in favor? Six? And opposed? One. The motion passes. Thank you very much. I think we'll take just a 2-minute break because I'm sure there are some people who will want to stampede out the room. Thank you very much. Okay, we're back on the air. Thank you very much. We have moved on to item 149, and as I mentioned way back at the beginning of the meeting, there's a items number 149 through 155 could, if we want, be considered as a block. Councillor McGinty.
I move that we take items 149 through 155 as a block.
I second.
And Councilor McGinty, could you just read the title line of these so we know which special funds they are?
These are the Sewer Fund, the Riverside Cemetery Fund, the Museum at Portland Headlight, Spurwink Church, Fort Williams Park Capital Fund, Jordan Trust Fund, Thomas Jordan Trust Fund, and the Rescue Fund.
So it's been moved and seconded to take these as a block. Is there any discussion?
No. Point I wanted to raise on the Thomas Jordan Trust Fund budget. I know that with the economy dipping, that we've been smacked on income. What used to be 6% income is now 2% income, and so forth. So I think it would be prudent for us to re-examine that in the coming year in light of the economy and try to make sure that our investments are producing the maximum available, because we have scholarships to do for the summer program and other people who apply for relief. So I think we should keep that in mind. I have no further comment on that.
That's excellent input. Thank you very much, Councillor Berry. Is there any other discussion? No. All in favor of take, did we? of taking them as a block.
Taking them as a block.
I'm sorry, I lost my place. Taking them as a block. All in favor of taking these as a block?
Oh, I thought we already did that, I'm sorry.
Well, if we did, we just did it again. It's unanimous. Okay.
Well,
now,
I said before, but the discussion goes now.
Okay.
Move for passage.
Okay.
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded to pass all of these. Any discussion? None? Okay. All in favor? It's unanimous. Councillor Carson?
No, wasn't I with the group?
I wasn't sure what that was, but you're with us. Okay.
I'm like, wait a minute.
We got the
picture of people out. Moving on, that brings us to item number 156. And again, there are a bunch of items that have to do with a variety of fees, various changes to fees that we are considering, and those would be items 156 through 166. Would anyone like to consider these as a block?
I move that we consider items 156 to 166 as a block.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. And Councillor Carson, could you just read the titles of each one of these so we know what we're talking about here?
Item number 156 reads the Codes Office Fees. These are a variety of fees, change of use permits, various permits that people have to get. Item number 157, Zoning Board Application Fee. Item number 158, Fees for Notary Public and Dedimus Judge Justice Services given by the town. Item number 159, Photocopy Fees. People who bring materials in that be photocopies, it's a fees adjustments. Item number 160, Insurance Card Fax Fee. There's a fee attached for when people have to have their insurance cards for registration of automobiles. Item number 161, Parking Violation and Towing Fees. This is items throughout the town for parking and towing. Item number 162, Consideration of Proposed Revised Policy for Checks Written on Accounts with Insufficient Balances. This is a standard fee. We've adjusted that fee for people who have for when the town has to have return checks. Item number 163 is mooring fees in the several areas of the town where you can buy a mooring location. And item number 164, rescue fees. These are fees for rescue services provided to the citizens of the community. There's adjustments in those fees. Item number 165, general fund overhead fee. Policy charge for all special funds and administrative overhead fee that would be applied by the town. Item number 166, consideration of adjusting certain library fines and fees. Those are the general library fees that you know, the lack of return of books or videos in a timely manner. Those fees would be adjusted to be with market.
Move for passage.
A second.
It's been moved and seconded to pass these in a block. Any discussions? Yes, Councillor McGinty.
No. Discussion on taking these things as a block?
No, we already voted on taking these as a block.
We just voted. Yep. It's okay, Henry. Did we?
Yes, we did.
Yes, we voted to move these to do these as a block. Sure. So we've already done that, and then Jack jumped on it and said move to pass them all.
Right.
So it came quick and fast.
We did vote on the block.
Okay, technically, God.
I don't think we did.
It's lucky this is my last meeting as chair because I'm losing it. Okay. Some of the councillors seem to think we've done it, but others think not. So let's take it. Let's move. Let's start over.
I moved it because I remembered looking back at the number, 156.
Yes, but did we? But we didn't vote. We didn't
as a block.
Yes, we didn't vote on taking them as a block. So let's vote on taking them as a block. All in favor? It's unanimous. Okay, and
now
then
Jack
moved
approval.
Nice approval seconded. Of them all, and you seconded.
And I seconded.
Oh, he seconded.
Somebody seconded it. Okay, and now it's time for discussion, and it's time for Councillor McGinty.
I'm going to be voting for these. My only concern is with item 165, which is a general fund overhead fee, and I expressed my concern. I think at our last workshop with the council. That, you know, for all these low years, we've never charged off the administrative fees to our special funds, such as the cemetery and the Fort Williams Headlight Fund. And again, it looks like one of these budget gimmicks, if you will, looking for revenue in different places. And even in the in the motion here, it says that the proceeds are general fund unallocated revenues. So they're not even directly going to support the administrative function. I mean, roundabout they do, obviously, but it's just a way of generating, the way I read it, it's just a way of generating funds for the general fund. And it's not offsetting any expenditures that we're making now for those administrative fees. And I'm concerned that we will continue to look at this as some form of revenue generating line in the budget, rather than simply to support the administrative functions for which you know, the administrators are supposed to be supporting these funds. So I'm just concerned. I will vote for this, but I'm concerned in the future that we watch this very carefully.
Thank you, Councilor McGinty. Other comments? Councilor Lynch.
More a question, I guess, than a comment. And I apologize if we discussed this in the work session and I've forgotten the answer. But on the rescue fees, all of the proposed rescue fees track the Medicare allowable fee, except for the top two. Our proposed fee is slightly lower in both instances than the Medicare allowable fee. And my question is, why do we not track the Medicare allowable fee?
It's simply a case of rounding, Counselor.
Well, should we round up?
The council sets the fees.
So we can round from 59 to 60?
You can round back up to the allowable amounts, but and you can charge more than the allowable amounts.
And you would
amounts. However, you'd only be reimbursed for up to the allowable amounts.
And I'm just interested in seeing that the town's rescue unit get reimbursed from Medicare for the amount that's allowable. So I would make a motion to amend the emergency, the ALS-1 emergency rate. And the BLS base rate to match the Medicare allowable rate.
I second the motion.
I don't see any reason on leaving federal money on the table, small as it may be. Thank you, Henry.
That was one of my two questions. I have one of them.
Okay. Councilor Roberts.
I agree with Councilor Lynch on that as well. I think we should be maximizing those revenues. There's no reason we couldn't go to $260 as opposed to $259.04. I don't believe we'd be sending out bills for the additional 96 cents anyway to collect it, but it would make, for bookkeeping purposes, probably would be easier, but I would defer to the manager on that, I guess, whoever's doing the billing, but I believe we contract that out as well.
We do.
So I would say let's just go with the Medicaid rate and collect as much as we can on it.
Councilor Carson, did you have a comment?
No, I was just wondering how the manager and the fire chief happened to set this. There must have been a reason for doing that, that we're not...
Yeah, the fire chief and I have had some disagreement on this along the way. he was looking for some higher rates than I was at one point. You know, I think it needs to be remembered when you're looking... There was a lot of concern a year ago when rescue rates were set.
Yeah.
In terms of that this was a new program, in terms of how much was going to be Medicare, how much was going to be insurance, how much was going to be private pay. When we set these rates, we're setting them for all rescue patients. Mm-hmm. We're not simply just setting them for Medicare. We're also setting them for the private care patients. If you look, for example, the ALS emergency rate, the proposed increase is from $200 to $250. That's a 25% increase. The BLS base rate is up $25 from $175. That's more than a 10% increase. And, you know, on down the list, the percentages vary, but, you know, definitely those first two are fairly significant percentages. That is why recognizing the hesitancy a year ago to institute fees, I think it was my impression, and I had some discussions with the chief about it, that we should continue to recognize that this, that we're still in the early stages of this, and continue to look at the revenues and continue to look at the patterns of how much is paid by Medicare and Medicaid and how much is private pay and different insurances. So that's why I come up with the amounts I did, and rounding. But I, for those particular ones, because they were, if you look at this, I think those were the biggest percentage increases. That's why I went with the amounts I did.
Councilor Barry?
Isn't it the practice not to send Dunning letters if there is no insurance or Medicare coverage?
The policy is to send an initial letter following on the first letter requesting payment. You know, beyond that, I don't want to describe all of our collection practices because I don't think it's really in our best interest to do so. Yeah. Because, you know, for me to say carte blanche that we wouldn't do XYZ, you know, might not be something that would be in the best interest of the rescue, first. And secondly, you know, in instances where we know that there's ability to pay, we might be a little more aggressive than in those instances where we believe that there's a possibility of an inability to pay.
Councilor Roberts.
From the experience we've had so far, how many people have been private pay? Has it been a high percentage or has it been fairly low?
I didn't bring all the percentages with me, but we have collected roughly more than 90% of what we're billed. And, you know, they classify, did you bring all the amounts with you?
When you say private pay, do you mean pay out of their pocket, not private insurance?
Right.
Yeah, very, very few.
Right.
Very few.
Yeah. So
we're not going to be really doing harm to anybody. And if there's anybody in that position, we can find a way to help them out.
Do we know how private insurance compares to Medicare? I mean, do they, usually Medicare pays less than anybody.
That's right.
We're not allowed to charge discriminatory rates to different individuals based on what they have for coverage.
But, I mean, we wouldn't be getting more, I mean, asking for more than insurance companies.
Yeah, let me take back what I just said. We could charge more, and the insurance companies might pay it, but there was a policy decision a year ago to peg it to the Medicare rates. You know, and even then we were, Phil had Chief McGoldrick, had a discussion with, you know, the woman who does the billing, and, you know, she tells us that, you know, the Medicare rate is in part determined by the market rate, so that if all the municipalities go up, the Medicare rate goes up. It's one of these, you know, it reminds me of some other things that I won't talk about. You know, there's almost, you know, it was, there's collusion in the system, and, you know, if we kept raising the rates, the Medicare rate would go up because that's the way the federal government foolishly pays, you know, in keeping with their sound economic principles. They do that, though. But that's, when we pursued this issue, that's what we were told, is that, you know, you ought to raise them considerably more because then the average Medicare rate would go up. And then, but, you know, again, you know, we don't run a rescue to make money. The whole purpose of setting these fees was to meet the needs of the patient and to provide additional funds for the equipment that the rescue needs in both the short term and in the long term. I have no objection to the amended motion. That's fine, but the council did seem desirous of more background, and I have gone on at some length doing that.
Okay, the motion has been amended, and I can't recall who
initially. It was a second.
For the amendment?
Yes.
Yes. So, does the original motioner, I can't remember who that was, are you in agreement? Do you want to just amend your original motion, or do we have to just act
on the amendment?
Vote
on the amendment.
Okay.
Yeah, one amendment first.
Then, unless there's no other comments, which I don't think there are, all in favor of the amended motion?
Well, what were the amounts again?
To bring them up to the Medicare.
Under item number 164, it's...
Oh, the original, you're going for the amendment, right?
Yes, for
which
the amendment.
Which was to...
Adopt column one.
Adopt the Medicare allowable column and under item number 164. So all in favor of amending the motion? It's unanimous. Okay, so now we have the amended motion. Is there
anyone else who wishes to make a comment?
I wanted to make a general comment while I had an opportunity on all of these fees and fee proposals and on the general budget. These came about as a result of a lot of effort by department heads and others over the past year, as well as by some staff members. I wanted to thank all of the department heads by name for all of the budget. We've thanked the superintendent, the manager, and the school board. And I think, you know, the council deserves praise as well, all seven of you, for your careful deliberations of the budget and your consideration of the needs. But I also wanted to thank Deborah Lane, the town clerk, for her work on the election budgets, the support throughout. Matt Sturgis, the assessor, for his help with the valuation that helped in the budget, as well as working the assessing budget. Sue Weatherby for the pool, the fitness center, the community center, the community services budget, as well as all her help with the schools. Jean Gross for taking on the Portland Headlight budget for the first time, understanding that and processing it. Ernie McBain, I think, and we've discussed several times during the budget process savings that have come about as during this budget process as a result of fuel amounts being negotiated, as well as energy efficiency savings. Paulina Portria, the school business manager, for a lot of different help throughout the budget process with the investments. Louise Strout, who inputs a lot of the information into the systems, who works in the school department with the accounts payable. Continuing back to department heads, Neil Williams, the chief of police, for really coming through. It's been a tough year for Neil with the budget, with a lot of questions being asked about a lot of items, and I praised his stalwartness throughout this, as well as his excellent work in the police budget. Bruce Smith, back there wondering if he had to come tonight, but all these building permit fee increases that were there, that again, he spent an awful lot of work on those. Jay Shermer, I think you all remember the memos from the library trustees that looked at a lot of different revenues, the detail within his budget. Phil McGuldrick, again, the fire, the rescue, the wet team, all the different companies, the buildings that he's involved in, and, you know, the fact that, you know, we're not spending a whole lot of money on new full-time positions, unlike almost every other community, is a credit to not only his work in the budget, but his work throughout the year. Maureen O'Meara on the planning budget, as well as, so many other issues that are tangential to that, involving so many issues in town. And last but not least, the guy, I don't know if he spends the most money, but he probably does. And, you know, the department head, it's been a real difficult 6 months, not only with the budgets, but also, you know, with a number of other really tough issues that they've dealt with, and working with all these fees, as well as, you know, some of the controversy over the buildings. And I couldn't work with a better team, and I really, really tremendously appreciate all of their efforts, not only on the budget, but also the work they do every day that I think, you know, makes my life an awful lot easier in terms of their dedication. So I wanted to go on at length.
I'll give them that.
Did I leave out anyone? I didn't name Bob Malley by name, I just said Bob. And
how about
I do have a few more names on my list here, though, that weren't department heads.
Did you mention?
Claudia Rackey.
Maureen, did you mention?
I did. Claudia Rackey, who helps out paying all the bills upstairs. Arlene Roquefort, who does so much of our work on health insurance, the different employee benefits, meeting the payroll. Barbara Ray, for all of her help, preparing all the budget documents. Lori Polanza, up in the Assessing Codes Planning Office, for helping to assemble so much information there. Harry Proudman and the cable TV staff for getting the word out. And last but not least, Wendy Dersowick, who, as you look at the work that she has done with our webpage in terms of getting the message out, getting the documents there for people to download in PDF format, and it's really a tremendous asset. So I really, again, thank the council for your indulgence in allowing me to spend this time. I appreciate all their efforts.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. And I would also like to add the council's thanks to Mr. McGovern, who has worked very long and hard through this whole process and has been extremely helpful to the council, and I think does an excellent job for the town. So we owe him our thanks also.
Madam Chairman, could I ask one quick more question here?
Certainly,
on item 160, this insurance card fax fee, what kind of card do you have to have? That is, if you have a bill showing that it was paid for insurance, is that good enough, or what do you have to have?
Well, we had a customer who came in last week whose number was changed by 911 and faxed his insurance, asked his insurance company to fax, and discovered he'd been driving around without insurance since January 10th. So it's a very important service that...
You mean a number of the address?
Yeah, that we provide in... it's a very important service we provide in encouraging people, as the state law requires, to provide a copy of their insurance card. Anyone can bring in their own insurance card and not pay the fee, but if they want to go to having it faxed, they have that extra step. His proposal is we would collect a $2 fee for it.
In other words, if you don't get your agent or company to fax the thing, you can't get a registration?
Well, you're sent one anyway by your insurance company. You can just bring that in and avoid the fee.
Okay.
Right. There's the one that they give you that you should be carrying around in your car usually. But
and
as has...
Person, they give you two, I think, for each.
As has happened to me, I've discovered that I haven't had it sometimes when I've registered my car. So it is a very useful service.
You have to have the card.
Yes.
A lot of people like not to know that.
Are there any other comments or discussion? No. Okay. We have a motion before us that was amended. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. And thank you to everyone out there who's been waiting so patiently for some closure on some of these budget issues. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. I hear none. Before we adjourn, I just want to note to my fellow councilors that after the meeting, we'd just like to move to the conference room briefly. We have a couple of questions to discuss having to do with various committees. Committee assignments for the upcoming months. And also, I just had a question. I'm going to a meeting tomorrow, and I just wanted to get some people's opinions. So, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
We adjourn.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor of adjourning? It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you.